Blessed be the Lord our God, and truly it is a blessed day as we move into our springtime, the lengthening days and the increased warmth of the sun. And we pray that that light truly will be within us and around us as we gather tonight, giving us the newness that we need to approach everything that we do, the openness that we need, the freshness that we need, so that every work that we endeavor, every undertaking that we look at, that it will truly be for your honor and glory, that all the people that we serve will truly know the blessing of your light, your truth, and your love. For this prayer and for every prayer, we say amen.
Thank you. Are there any additions to the agenda? Additions? Citizens' comments.
Laura Davis with the Life After School program would like to request an approval to change from Thursdays to Tuesdays for K through 3 skating, effective immediately. We currently have 10 to 16 students on Thursday. We feel the kids would enjoy skate a day if they were able to attend with the other children. And so I don't know, Vicki.
Yeah.
That's agreed.
Mm-hmm. The only reason we bring this before the council is because when you approved for to use it for the Life After School program, you approved those certain nights that she presented. And so, just so that we can change it, it's fine. Her and Vicki have worked some things out.
If it's all right with Vicki, I make a motion to accept the changes as they are, or as she wants them.
Yeah, second.
Been a motion and second. Is there any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Consent agenda. Approved minutes for the regular meeting of 3/18/2014. Approved appropriation ordinance 3/19/2014 in the amount of $1,775. Approved appropriation ordinance 04/01/2014 in the amount of $86,143.96. And approved appropriation ordinance 04/01/2014A in the amount of $11,109.65.
So moved.
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All in favor? Motion carries 4-0. Chief Sanders.
I don't have anything.
Okay. Chief Saylor.
I don't have anything either.
John?
Well, Trey and Dwayne are here as to talk about any changes in the policies from last year to this year. Okay.
Do they have, did you guys have data compromise brochures for the spray?
There's a few things that we just want to visit a little bit about. We all but have this policy wrapped up. There's two things that we're going to, well, there's actually three things we're going to go over tonight. The first one being a data compromise coverage. This is currently not on your policy today. And all it basically is a coverage that will allow, it'll cover you if something, if your computer were to get stolen, hacked into, breach, data breach of some sort. This is the coverage for that. It's not something, we just wanted to bring it to the council. I don't know if it's something you guys are interested in, but it's not currently covered today. The coverage, the cost for this is $677, correct, $677 per year for this.
Internet and email, but databases are where anybody can get to them.
we back up to a backup site, off-site.
Okay.
But again, that's secure.
And they probably cut the liability coverage or something.
Absolutely. The one person that can get in is Randy, and he has liability coverage for that as well.
So is there really any need for us to have this?
You know, there's always things happening. It seems like the criminals can stay ahead of us all. And every single clerk's conference that we have, there's new things that they're bringing in. You probably hear it too at the school. But how you can protect yourself on all of those things, you do what you can, but it does seem like they're always ahead of us now. Whether, I mean, I'd like to say I don't really have a fear that this could happen, but I don't know enough about how all that crime works to know that that's not possible. I mean, we've talked to Randy, we've got all of our security, our firewalls, and all of that. So, to my knowledge, and to the best of Randy's knowledge, we're good.
If you flip it over on the back, there's some examples of just some different scenarios that could happen where this policy would come into play. But once again, we're not saying that you have to put this on the plan, but we just want you to know that it's available and that it's currently not on.
So we can always add it later if you look it over and have some other questions.
I've heard one council member question the need for it. What is everybody else's opinion? Do you have an opinion? Do you think we need it? Do you don't think we need it?
Yeah, I would just call and activate it right before you turn in the claim. Well, if we have our off-site storage that's secure, then I don't really, at the moment, I don't really see us needing it. But like you said, you never know. Cyber criminals are constantly ahead of the game, and they know what's going on. And they will definitely have push it anyway.
Do we have everything to have access to that kind of stuff anyway?
Add it if you don't need it. You can always tell them it's an April Fool's joke.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is that we're going to pass on the coverage.
I would say pass right now. Unless we come up with a... You know, Jonna would be the first person to know and let us know, and then we could turn it in that way.
Or if y'all hear something on the news.
Yeah.
Okay, I don't have a handout for the second thing, but it's earthquake coverage. Now, this may sound really ridiculous, but it's becoming more and more prevalent here in Kansas. It's, again, not currently on the policy. It would be something that you could add. Obviously, there would be a cost. It has a 10% deductible, and it's on the property. So it's for the property coverage. 10% deductible for earthquake. And now that we do not have an exact price on, but we can give you a very close ballpark figure of between $700 and $800, not including the nitrate plant as of right now.
And that's per year?
That's per year. Okay. With the 10% deductible, which may seem high, but let's just take, for instance, the water tower. Don't know what an earthquake would do to it. If it came crashing down, you'd have that deductible, but it would still be better than nothing at all. So, or any brick building of some sort or anything like that. So, the nitrate plant might add maybe $100-$150 extra to the total coverage. But those are ballpark. It's a pretty extensive process to get an exact quote, because they ask for all the building locations and a bunch of specific things, but that's going to be close. But before we did all that, we wanted to run it by you guys.
Has there ever been an earthquake in St. John?
If there has, I think it would get there kind of a tremor, but not anything.
Is there someone that can legally say whether it was or whether it wasn't an earthquake if the water tower falls over? Your adjustment. If an earthquake hits and a water tower falls there, everyone's going to know it.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if anybody here's lived through an earthquake, but there is no question when an earthquake hits, you know it's an earthquake. Again, I think this is something that we can hold off on. I mean, do we even know whether we have any major or even minor fault lines running close to us or around us, through us? I mean, I don't know. It's something I could look up, but I really don't know.
Kansas City.
I know there's one somewhere close, but I just don't know how close to us. So
maybe we want to do some research.
Yeah, I could do a little bit of research on it and kind of just run around curiosity and pass it on to you so that you know.
Okay.
Again, I think it's something, I don't know if the rest of council, but I think it's something we should hold off on for now.
Yeah. No, that's fine. We just want to bring it to your attention. You guys can talk about it. Okay. The other thing that we've thought about is right now you guys have a $1,000 deductible on your property. Have you guys considered, or would it be an option for you guys to think about a $3,000 deductible? It would obviously lower the premium a little bit, and in turn, you might be able to take some of that savings and put it towards either data compromise or earthquake coverage and not have any extra expense if you went to a little higher deductible. Now, that would be on your property. That was just something that
I would be in favor of raising the deductible. I mean, $3,000.
And that is
far as damage, ain't much damage. So.
Per occurrence, or that is a once deductible. So if you have a big storm that takes out 25 buildings, it's a $3,000 deductible. It's not per building.
I would rather see it go towards flood insurance.
Well, I'm not saying we have to put it towards anything, but I'm in favor of raising the deductible and saving a little.
Yeah, I'm in favor of that as well. Right here.
Do we want to stick $3,000, or do we want to raise it even a bit higher and maybe go 5?
Can you give us a breakdown? I mean, do you know what the difference is?
What the savings would be?
Yeah,
right now.
Ballpark, Dwayne, correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, your biggest savings will be to go to $3,000. I'm guessing that's going to be $700-$800, probably another $300 or $400 more, give or take just a little bit, to go to $5,000. The big jump will be the first one, but the second jump wouldn't be as much.
Okay.
$1,700 to $1,800 if
I go. I'd say about a total. If you go to 5,000, I'm guessing you'll save $1,000. Probably about 700. If you go to 3,000, another 300 on top of that. So probably around a grand. Your property premium is only 20,000. I say only. It's 20,000, so it's going to be 5% of that, roughly, maybe. I'm guessing.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Three or five.
I'd say go 5.
Yeah, I don't see out of pocket for 5,000. I mean, my health insurance is $3,000.
Yeah, we'll say.
Okay.
You want a motion?
Yeah, do you want?
Please.
I'll make a motion to raise our deductible.
Insurance, property insurance
deductible from $1,000 to $5,000.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Motion carries.
Okay, that's all I have. Thank you.
Flood insurance.
Flood insurance?
How expensive?
On what? On this? On every building?
What were you thinking, Kevin?
Well, I just want some rain.
Oh, okay.
I was going to say, why do you want flood insurance? We're not on the floor.
They think it caused it.
That's positive. Right. I like it. Yeah.
That's okay. Okay.
Jim. Any questions on any of the insurance? We'd be happy to.
Yeah, we've gone over it pretty extensively, I think. So those were the only things that I really felt like needed to come to you guys.
Yeah.
Okay. Just a special thanks to John and to you. Mel's been a huge help. Adam and the rest. So thanks for all of your help in putting this all together for us.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Have a good night.
First report. I really don't have anything else.
First thing I have is on communication of dilapidated property. You all had a letter in your packet, I believe. That was on my list of properties that we had looked at, and this is probably one of the more quite a bit of work to respond to the videos that the program has. You can see the picture.
They didn't have the pictures.
Oh, so you did pictures?
No, I didn't make.
We'll take your word for it.
Anyway, so we're going to get a letter out to the property owner. I haven't done it yet. I've been busy trying to get this cool stuff around, so we'll get it addressed quickly.
Where are we at on the? We had talked a while back about the list of stuff, but getting letters out.
Right, that's on the list, and it's, I mean, got to decide what's that's important, but I haven't had time to do it. I've forgotten it. Still
where are we at on the other?
Everybody, if I'm come down tomorrow.
They come down tomorrow.
Yeah, yep, these guys put me in town, so.
Okay.
Property, so.
So there's no way to tie. There's no way of tying these two together then.
I don't think so.
Okay.
We get started taking pictures of tearing down stuff and stuff.
Process takes a
while. Anyway, here it goes.
Okay.
Next item is swimming pool coating. I've done some research as far as various options to redo the pool up there. When that pool was new, they put on a thorough seal, which is the best way to put it. It's kind of like a whitewash. It's got a plasticizer in it, and it's just got under so thick, and it just comes off its slab. We switched to a rubberized pool paint, and it helped some, but you know, your paint's only as good as your base. This is a really bad year. We're having to a degree, but this is about the worst I've seen it coming through a winter. It's just, I mean, I was up there, I had Warren Brothers up there do a test blast with, see how long it take the blast to cool off, and just when I was had the leaf blower up there blowing up the sand, there was paint coming off. So we really need to do something, so that's why we're looking at it. You remember at budget time we did establish, we saved $5,000 last year, we have another $5,000 this year's budget to put towards any type of coating project, whether it be epoxy, PVC liner, or fiberglass. So I've got three options here for some room. Equipment, you can fix it yourself. yourself. If you have to be prepared, they've had a couple of little things they've had to do. So that's what we're looking at there. And that was to do the main pool and the waiting pool. The prices are $53,841. So before going farther, I will throw out as far as financing, we can get this on a lease if we want you to pay for it. We also have the Cornwell Fund, which has some money available toward we can use toward paying this. Maybe a combination rather than leaving the Cornwell Fund, leave something in a combination where we already have accumulated basically.
How much is in the Cornwell Fund?
There's
just so we know.
A little over $31,000 in there that would be available.
And we have 10 that we've set aside already.
We have 5 that was transferred into capital projects, and we have 5 available to transfer in this year's budget for that. So, yes, we have 10 available to spend outright.
Just kind of any of the scenario to look at, you know, you could do, you know, 20,000 out of the Cornwell, and 10 from what we have, and then put the rest on the lease or whatever combination you wanted. That'd be up to you guys how you wanted to do that. So,
do you know what kind of time frame we could have on the lease? So we're talking 5 years, 10 years?
He said probably no more than 5, I think, is what he would be willing to give him. And when I first started talking to him, that was about a $40,000 lease. He said probably no more than 5.
Well, I'm going to say I would think if you're 20, he's going to even shorten it up.
Yeah, maybe he could. So. So,
and if you were at 20, that would fit into what you've kind of set up to be putting aside each year. That would plus a little interest to add a little bit to that. So, but it would be doable within the budget that we have.
Okay. The other towns think that they're probably going to make 20 years.
No one really said that. I mean,
it's close. They're within 4.
Yeah, I mean, I can say they, the city of Oxford is one that was just. I mean, that guy was tickled to death with it. I mean, they were very pleased with it.
Well, I would say what. I know Mel and I talked about this too, but you know, they come out with a 10-year warranty. To get another 5, it's a fifth of the cost almost.
Yeah.
I'm guessing somewhere between 10 and 15, this thing starts. Happen to have some repairs done to it, I'm taking it.
I mean, they're covering themselves for
disaster.
Possibilities.
So. Yeah.
The next choice, this is a, pass this around. This is a fiberglass, and this will be completely white. This company started in 62, and they started out with hot tubs and spas and whatnot. And this guy developed this process, basically, as far as the full-depth resin, or that's what they specialize in. I'm not saying there's no one else that does it, but this is just a sample. You can see in here, pass around, when they spray it on, of course, it's got the fiberglass, and then they've got a chopper that chops up the fiberglass and lays it in there, and you can kind of see it. It is reasonably flexible, but the pigment they put in there is a full depth white. So in other words, if it gets scratched or cracks or whatever, you're not going to see a color like that underneath. It'll be completely white. So I called around to several places, notably the city of Pratt used to have this on their pool. They had some concrete issues, and that's where a lot of these, like this PVC liner and this is a lot of where they use this. They've got some issues, and basically they're relining the pool to keep it from leaking or just make it smooth again. This is only has a 5-year. I'm sorry, I should have passed this other stuff. There's some pictures. This is City of La Crosse's pool before they put that on. Anyway, this is how their pool started out and what they ended up with.
We weren't really talking about doing a small waiter, were we, of anything?
the medium, this will, you can do the, and that's on that other proposal with the liner, was the intermediate pool.
Right, they call it the large wader and then the small wader.
Yeah, we weren't gonna do the, I mean, they're offering to do the small baby pool, if you wanna call it that, so. The liner, the PVC liner, the person didn't feel that was a good option for them to put that on that small one, but they're making that available there, so. But anyway, to do the main pool is $39,886, and the intermediate pool or the large wader is $8,460, and they said they would do the small baby pool for $3,250, which makes it $52,596. But they only have a 5-year guarantee on there.
Right, but if you're just comparing apples to apples, right, we're only looking at $48,346.
Right.
48,346.
You
only have a
5-year. And it's just got a 5-year.
Well, I'm just saying, yeah, there's the same pools. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
Everyone said that I talked to you, they had this down. Great company, came back, anytime there was any issues, they came back and fixed it, finished the story on the crack pool. They had it on for a number of years. They had some cracks and whatnot. They came back and fixed it, but at the end of, I think they had it on, I don't know if it's 10 years, what, they tore it all out and went, they repaired their concrete and have gone to an epoxy coating, epoxy paint. They feeling was that it's something they could maintain themselves, didn't require anybody to come in. If they had a section of the pool that the coating failed or got stained, they could recoat that themselves and not have to depend on them. Of course, there's really no warranty on the coverage or the coating on the epoxy. Okay, the next one, this is a cost from Warren Brothers and Great Dane Sanding to do the sandblasting. They came up and did a test blast in several sections at the pool to see an estimate on how long it would take to get down to a good coating to where that you can get good adhesion with the epoxy. And some of you that came up and looked at it, what I showed them was that this ThoroSeal will not come off 100%. There's places where it is really stuck on there, and if they try and get that all off, where you had bare concrete showing, it really abraded it, and Mark, Kevin, Troy, and Sherry saw it, but it really went to work on the concrete, so it was really a detriment to try and get it completely off. On the floor, where this is an issue or might be considered an issue, is that some places it's real smooth or it went down to the concrete, and where it left a little bit, it kind of a irregular pattern on it. I did go up there just to see, what it would take to get it off, and just, took a big grinder up there with a 24 grit sanding disc on it, and yeah, you can smooth it up, but that's really not a practical solution to that. I talked to John Mansell, and I was working on this and got too late on me to get a price on it, but they ran a concrete polisher or grinder you can get probably from Wichita Concrete Accessories would have that, and probably a wet something you use with a water and a stone, and we could take that out of it and get it smoothed up more. With paint over the top of it, I mean, is that something we would address, or you think, it's a little rough. I mean, some people may find it hard on their kids' feet or whatever, but it's something we could, we could address if we go that way.
Well, I don't think it'd be any harder on their feet than something like that would be.
So, I mean, that's a, a plastic,
right,
kind of a uniform thing, so. But I'm just saying that's an option. And then the top edge where that ThoroSeal's been put on for years and years, it's extra heavy, and when they blasted it, it's not gonna, even when they get done, it's gonna be fairly rough, and it might be kind of hard on somebody sliding in, out, as far as that, snag a swimsuit or whatever. So we could whip by hand with a sander, we could probably lose most of that, just by going around the top edge and and address that part, so.
Does that have to be done anyway, if you do this liner?
Not, they put a felt down, it's a polyester felt, and that would, unless when the installers get here, the guy that was, you know, selling it didn't think it'd be necessary, but they may say, well, it's gonna last a lot longer if we, you know, take kind of that ragged edge off. But they put a polyester felt down to kind of protect the liner itself from situations like that, but he didn't say it would have to be done, so. So to get all the pools blasted down, and Chris Warren indicated he thought he would bring three trucks down, and he thought he could do the large pool in one day, you know, long full day. If it didn't go as quick as what they thought, they might have to come back. If that, there'd be an extra, you know, $300 on top of that. So I figured the worst case scenario, and then the baby pool, that will be a separate trip itself. So to completely get all the pools sandblasted and ready for epoxy paint would be $8,374.40.
That's painted too, or just ready to paint?
That's ready to paint. Now, if you go, you know, you look at it, you know, if we go with the liner, we don't have that expense. But the epoxy paint, City of Great Bend does some of their pools with this, not all of them, but it's Sherwin-Williams and they sell it Great Bend. I talked to the Evan up there at length. The City of Hoisington has used this paint, and they're at 7 years, and they're, you know, probably looking at painting. So if you want to figure that into the life cycle, you know, and the paint to do this, and this is, you know, when you get to paint stuff, sometimes it takes a lot of paint to cover, but from what he's indicating, it probably would cost. We're looking at $2,149.40. So to blast everything, get paint on it, we're looking at $10,523.40. And so, and that's adding another coating after either 5 or 7 years. So if you want to look at 14 years or 10 years, that's what your cost is.
But then you have the labor of employees.
Yeah, we've got the labor to paint it. We, you know, paint it every year, but, you know, it's, at least the paint that goes on, you know, will hopefully will stay on. Now, that is one of the things, what I had to mention that, Evan up there with selling the epoxy paint says he's had experience where people have painted over even after a sandblast. He says you can sandblast and everything already looks good, but he said you may have some places where it's going to come off. He says it'll fool you. You think you got everything off, all it takes is a little water to get underneath it and go through it, and so it could pop. So it's not, once again, it's not 100% deal. So. So to back up, to really give you a good what it'll cost to get it done this time, it's with one coat of paint and sandblasting, $8,374.40. But to bring it up to the life of, you know, 10-year warranty or 14, whatever, that was the $10,523. So to get it blasted and painted this year, if you want to do that, it's the $8,374. We can, and I'm going to, if we go that way, I'm going to go do a little bit of, usually we get up there and we've got, you know, like 5 or 6 guys painting, you know, trying to get it done, and if we're going to go with a clean sandblast, we're probably going to limit it to maybe 4 guys, you know, kind of split up, so it's going to take a little bit longer, but we can paint the pool in the morning, you know, with you know, 5 or 6 guys, so. You know, so you're looking at a couple days, you know, probably. And with the sandblasting, we have to do the prep work as far as all the masking off of the lighting and anything that, you know, we use double layers of duct tape and have to make some boards to cover up the skimmers, and we're responsible for getting the sand out of the pool. So there'll be some more time on that. But once the blast is done, you know, that's a one-time expense to a degree, as far as, you know, we won't have to do that every time we paint. You know, next time you paint, you'll go right over the top of it.
I know it's a lot of stuff, so.
So what's council thinking?
What was the timeline on this liner?
Everyone I talked to, we can have a pool on time.
Okay.
Regardless. In fact, if we do the sandblasting, the Warren Brothers will probably be here next week. Or could be. Didn't promise, but he said they want to get it done this in April. So, and if you do it, the epoxy, once you get your second coat on, it's a week before you can fill it. So, we can get that done.
Just a day between coats, too, then?
Next day.
With the other surfaces, Mel, is there any difference in how you clean? And
most everyone, the superintendent there at Oxford says, you know, they've had some staining issues, and they actually use, I don't know if they recommend it or not, but, you know, it is PVC, but they've used a dilute muriatic acid to get any staining out. The other guy I talked to, he said they just basically pressure wash it and clean it up, do some scrubbing.
The daily stuff that the guards would be doing?
No one indicated anything extra would be required, you know, as far as that part of it. The paint, you know, would be pretty much what they're used to, other than, you know, it'd be a lot better surface to work on. But.
You know how many funds are available in that corner lot?
$31,000 is what is available to use.
We don't have any other park fund or anything that we can take anything out for that.
No, not at the Edna Smith, I think that's a $10,000 to start out with, and we can't use the principal, so it would just be $17,000.
We've still got over $22,000.
Yeah, but if we put on a lease and $5,000 a year that we set aside.
Yeah. That would be doable, wouldn't it?
Is there 10 available above and beyond this 31, or is that 31 counting 5 of that?
No. In your capital projects fund, if you look at this, you have $5,000 set aside for the swimming pool.
Right.
Already. We have in our budget for 2014 $5,000 to transfer into that. So we would have $10,000 in the capital projects designated to the pool.
Plus 31, if we got whatever we wanted to do out of that.
If you wanted to use all of the formula fund.
When Mel was talking, the other, which I don't know if it's a drawback or a liability, much more than the pool just being down there, but we will have to leave water all but about 3 foot down. I mean, to where it fills in year-round. So, I mean, I don't know if that would add to our liability. I mean, I doubt it's much more liability than the hole in the ground that's there anyway, year-round. But
right. And that's what the company recommends. The guy from Sedan said he did that the first couple of years, and he said cleanup was a lot easier. He just drained it down just like we do.
I figured it was to keep sunlight maybe off direct.
It would help. I mean, you're right. In fact, he said you can get an option, and you can get like a colored section to go around the top like so it looks like tile. He said the only trouble is any side that gets long afternoon sun, he said it's just faded out. So, I mean, that's, you're going to have that at whatever, you know, is not below the water line. But he's done it that way and hasn't had any real issues, I don't know if it would necessarily void your warranty if you didn't follow this, but he just said it's a lot easier to clean up, you know, and that's what he started doing, so.
Are you leaning towards the liner then?
Yeah.
Yep.
I'd sure like to see a long solution.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's where I'm leaning.
That other town is just 4 years out, 20-year solution, that would be nice.
That's, you know, there's no guarantee, but you
I'll
know
what it works. Right. Yeah.
So the one that Stafford had, it was the...
It was a different brand. I will say, a different company and a different brand. They had several issues. They got sticky on them. I think they had, might have had some leaks, you know, too. The guy from Sedan said, we talked about the extended warranty. He said, that's so easy to fix. They had a couple of cuts for whatever reason. And the guy from Fort Hays University, there's an indoor pool, but he didn't tell me what, but they dropped something into the pool and it put a hole in it, you know, put a hole in the liner. And so they had they repaired it themselves. So, I don't think the extended warranty would be money well spent at all. May be wrong, but I mean, if it falls to pieces after 10 years, but you know, we haven't seen that from the people we've talked to. So.
What's your personal opinion?
You know, it's council's choice. If you want to go in for, you know, we won't, you know, we're used to doing the work up the pool. Once it's sandblasted and painted, we can sure do it. It's, you know, we've got the money to handle that. If you want a new-looking pool, you know, really freshen it up, then the liner is definitely the way to go. So. Thank you. I never done it. I did just about how you would.
Guys are leaning towards the liner, I'd need a motion to go that direction. And we want in the motion to include where, what monies you want to pull from where, and how much we want to try and look at financing.
Would it be good to pull half of that corn wheel? No, 15, 16,000.
It's totally up to you guys.
What other fund? I mean, we use that fund for some little deals here and there too. But
we really haven't. We asked to use it for the sound system, you know, for the Jubilee. We haven't used much out of the Cornwell for several years.
What do we get a year interest basis?
It's so little now because right. Yeah. Interest
so is. This is going to be if we dip into it very hard, it's going to be very slow.
It's going to be very slow, no matter what. It's not increasing very fast at this point.
If it's not a fund that you think in the next 5 to 10 years we're going to have to pull out of hard for something,
I don't have that.
Well, I know none of us do. But what I'm saying is,
no, we don't. I guess it's not a budgeted fund, and it's not something that you right. know. It is specific to the parks and.
Maintenance of city.
What if we take $20,000 out of the Cornwall fund, $10,000 that we have, and finance the rest?
That still leaves a nice chunk in the Cornwall fund.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah.
I mean, taking as much out of it without depleting it.
Yeah. Right, exactly.
And we don't need to pay interest. We don't need to.
What is the interest rate, did you say? Mr. Bonner?
No.
Okay, so the motion I need would be to approve the installation of the Renesis PVC pool system.
Before we do this, depending on what his terms and everything else are, if we decide to go this route and we decide not to finance any of it, is there another fund that we can pull out of it at all?
You can transfer from the water and light fund, which I would think would be a little bit risky this year, being right. So we have the catalytic converters and the nitrate removal plant, you know.
Capital improvement?
That's what we already have.
Okay.
We really, I mean, And then I can amend the budget if we would need to, as far as an extra transfer, you know, we would have to...
I doubt that it'd be bad enough that we wouldn't want to do that, but I'm just...
He's already done.
I'd just like to have it so that we knew we could do it, otherwise if we go ahead and approve this, because the way I take it, we need to get it approved no matter what we're doing so it can get done.
But in your motion to approve, like Mayor said, we need to allocate where that money's coming from in that motion. You can, if for some reason the lease is not what you choose to go with, I guess you could change that and do another motion the next meeting to say where you're going to get those funds from.
Well, I was just saying, I just want to leave that open since we don't have any
I'm just trying to think through as we're talking the correct way to do that. And even as I'm thinking this through, probably if we're going to use the transfer, the capital projects, the $10,000, we need to make a motion to transfer that $5,000 before we use it out of capital projects. Okay, so it's just a motion to transfer the $5,000 from the general fund to capital projects fund as budgeted.
So moved.
Second.
So any further discussion? All in favor? Motion carries.
So if we make the motion to pull $20,000 out of Cornwall Park and the $10,000 out of the capital improvement or the capital project fund for the liner, the Reno system liner, and then finance the rest or attempt to, I guess. I mean, how do you phrase it? I mean, so you have that option, or it doesn't matter at this point. We can always change that.
Are we going to have to come back and approve the lease once we get to that stage anyway?
Well, that's what I'm saying. If we wouldn't approve the lease and we already approved this, I'm just trying to make sure we have the funds to go ahead and do what we said we were going to do.
Okay.
That's the only thing I'm saying.
In the water and light pump, right now the other balance is $676,000. Of the $920,000 that's encumbered, I'm assuming part of that is a $750,000 nitrate plant.
Yes, this is at the end of February.
Right. What is the additional?
Part of it's the rice knee shaft, but then there was a balance still in that.
Okay. Yeah, recall. We're saving it back.
We saved that some, but not total. And the difference on that was the gold piece as well. Correct. So.
Okay, so I'll have to pull at a lease for the rice for the catalytic conversion.
Not the whole thing.
No, but for part.
Yes.
Okay. Of this $676,000, how much of that is operating budget for this year?
Will be the texture. So the side will be the smooth part, and then you
you've got two choices on your check. Check. The only other lease that we have, well, we have the two truck payments and then the nitrate water removal payment right now, right?
Yes. Emissions for the power plant, $100,000 set aside for that. And your modify the CAT unit. Per mandate, is that part of
that's,
that?
That would go forward.
Okay, so we have $110,000.
So we're only, we're talking putting $10,000 on the lease. Is what you're saying?
No, that's just what we've accumulated.
$110,000 is what we have accumulated towards that. It's encumbered, it won't come out of the next budget. It will come out of this cash budget, this cash balance.
What I'm asking for is what, how much are we going to have to put on the lease?
What's your total amount? We have 110 to put towards it.
I just want to make sure how many leases and whatever dollar amounts we have.
Yeah, with the exception of testing. We'll test sometime next month, I think, the way she talked.
So we're looking at another... ...11-12 years of payments on that?
Probably. I would guess you want to do 10-year lease on that. that we'll be getting our new information with the new amortization since we made our big payment. You know, that's a pretty low interest rate, so paying off some of this other faster might be a better option than trying to pay that off faster. We can look at those things.
I guess my only problem with going to the liner, and I understand why you don't want to do that, is the debt load.
We're supposed to operate off of a budget, not finance.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not saying the liner ain't the way to go, but I mean, if you're at, we're going to add another 100, say 15,000 to what our debt load already, but unless we can pay that off without going to the lease program.
What do you think, Bill? Without having dug deep enough into the numbers, I mean, just looking at what I've got in front of me, I think that $12,000 out of water might, out of the light and water fund is not going to make a huge difference in the grand scheme of things. But that's up to council. I would much rather see us pay for something than finance. That's what
we're going to do. I mean, the only reason I'm saying that though is every other time we come in, we have another government mandate thrown at us.
Right, that's true.
Yeah. That we may or may not have to lease money for, so it, I mean, it's not like the pool's a money maker anyway. Why, right, yeah, it's a huge bill, but what I'm saying is why add interest on top of that? To me, if we can't do it with cash money, then let's go a cheaper route. I mean, I'm not saying the liner's a bad deal. I mean, if we can do it cash wise, then say let's do it. Otherwise, let's look at something else.
You could lease it, and if we have those funds at the end of the year, go ahead and lease off. You know, and that way you're not, we would still have to do a budget. Yeah, I think I'd have to amend the budget so that we can do that transfer. But it's not a big deal. It's not probably good at all. We just need to make that decision end of October, 1st of November, so that it can get recorded through the county estate. Budget amendments. On a normal year, I wouldn't have any qualms about the 20,000, but I just remember last year we really worked over that fund pretty hard when we budgeted, and just am not real confident. Yes, I haven't looked at it that close, and we're so early into the year, it's just hard to know.
I mean, maybe we should consider going the cheaper route and then consider this maybe for next year, next season.
But then we're just throwing away $4,000.
That's another thing. We're just throwing that money away again. So.
Well, you'd be throwing a lot more than $4,000.
Yeah. You know, it's 10 feet. Sam blasts it and pucks paints it. Yeah. Well,
theoretically, you shouldn't have, hopefully, have to do much of any product.
You might be able to skip 2 years.
Well, that's it. That, why is it got 7 years out of there?
Oh, yeah. Well, that sounded better.
Well, I mean, we might not. You might have to repaint the whole thing next year, too. You don't know.
You might go, let's say, 5 years at the end of the 10-year warranty of the liner, not saying it wouldn't keep on going. You know, you can look at it that way. With one paint job in between there, at the end of 10 years or 14 years, whatever it turned out, you're looking at $10,523. But that doesn't count, you know, the polishing the floor and all that kind of stuff. So the initial cost is going to be significant. You know. But then after that, to refresh the surface, you know, a little over $2,000. Either 5 or 10 years or 2 years or whatever. Yeah, you're right. It could be sooner. But.
So does she need to retract the motion?
No, transfer is
the transfer was just to move the money.
Okay.
One way or the other, we're going to spend it.
We haven't made a motion what way we're going.
Yeah. Okay. I'll move to do the $8,300 worth of sandblast and the $2,100 worth of epoxy paint.
Okay. Is that all?
Okay. All the sandblasting, worst case scenario, including the paint and everything, was $8,374.40.
And then the additional was to do another paint around somewhere down the line.
Yeah. The other $2,000 to get it up to 10 was, you know, either 5 or 10 year refresh. So.
So
the numbers we're looking at is the $8,374.40.
Okay. So let's do. 9,000,
not to exceed 9,000. That's doable. Okay. And that's for the sandblasting and painting part of it. Mm-hmm. If we're off a little bit on paint, you will have to get some more, but that does not cover the polishing of the floor or anything else, but you know, we can take that out of the regular pool budget. I mean, that's.
So. Well, I'll just say either that or we got $10,000 set aside, we can just make the motion not to exceed $10,000.
Okay.
And give him the full $10,000 in case we got to polish it.
That's fine. Okay. Is
sandblasting epoxy paint?
Is that all three pools? Yes. Do I have a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Okay, next item.
Can we add to come out of capital projects?
Yes. Contract labor.
Okay. I visited with Rod in regard to our workers like Steve Scholes, Mark Johnson. Currently would be what we've been classifying as contract labor. And after visiting with Rod, that isn't probably a correct classification. We probably need to be higher than as part time. You might explain.
You're dictating basically the hours and the circumstances and the time. That takes it out of contract labor. Contract labor, they'll come in and contract a job, go do it, and you pay for the job. You're controlling the hours, controlling the time, controlling the location, everything on it. That's an input. That's not contract labor. The IRS will look at it as an employee situation, and that's where your real headache will come in from how you're doing it. The farmers like to try to get by with that all the time. Once in a while it bites when it gets caught, but it's not a contract labor situation.
So that sounds like basically what we need to do is either get an application or pull an application from the file somewhere beyond and have them fill out the proper paperwork and set them as employees at whatever the hourly rate is that we're paying them now.
Yeah, and I talked to your insurance man on that too, on another situation bringing that up here a while back, and he basically said the same thing.
Need a motion to hire Steve Schultz and Mark Tompkins on a part-time as-needed basis.
Do we still need Mark?
We still use him. Some. I mean, if we get in a bind and we've got a bad storm, we'll probably use him. Because there isn't enough of us to go around if the trucks are going out. So that'd be the reason we'd use him. We used him last week a little bit. We'd done something we never did before, and we generated against the tie and pushed back to Midwest Energy, which is something none of us had ever done. So to save face and not have an accident and turn the lights off for everybody, I thought it'd be a little more comfortable if there was two operators there that knew what they were doing. So Mark and I both were there most of the day when we did that. So, but we don't use him a lot. I mean, we will. I'm sure I'd still like to have the option to use him. Springtime coming with storms the way they are. It's a pretty nice cushion to have.
It would be more of an emergency kind of thing.
Got two guys that have started an engine once. You know, I mean, that's it.
Steve Schultz and Mark Tompkins at the hourly rate that they are currently being paid as contract labor.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
So I have.
Jeff, dairy truck repair?
We've noticed in the last week that we've got a wheel cylinder leaking on that digger truck. We took it out to Larry Fisher, had him look at it and write an estimate. The estimate to repair it is just under $1,800. But the truck is 31 years old. It needs to see the mechanic that we use for the digger and the bucket truck. He's out of Osborne. But I talked to him yesterday on the phone, and he feels like that if you put very much money into this truck, you're probably wasting it. The trade-in value on it is very little. The hydraulic pressure is way down on it. It took Justin and I almost an hour to pull a pole out here on a streetlight pole out here on 4th Street about 3 weeks ago or a month ago. And we ended up having to dig beside it. It just doesn't have any pull to it anymore. It's just wore out. But I called Rich and talked to him about that truck. And I said, is there anybody around that has anything that is got some age on it that we could afford? And he said that Midwest Energy was trading off. They traded off one this spring. And I called the guy that's ahead of procurement for Midwest Energy out of Hayes, and he told me that it might or it might not be too late to catch that truck. It's a truck that came from their fleet, and they're going to trade in another one. This one was a 2002, and they're going to trade in a 2005 later on this year. And they're both 47-foot trucks. They'd be comparable to the one that Kevin has, which is basically a Telelec Commander or a D-47 Alltech, which has a shiv height of 45 to 47 feet. The truck we have now is a Captain. It's a Telelec Captain. They quit building them in the early 90s. The shiv height on it's 41 feet. It basically can't set a pole over a 40-foot tall pole is all it could set. And we do set some 45s. But the hydraulic pressure to hold these big poles up, we just don't have it. We've tightened the rope winch on it, and we're about half afraid to pick anything up in a phase that's very heavy if it's loaded with a cross arm and that stuff. And we're getting into the season where we'd really like to start building some line. We can do the smaller ones, I think, and probably get along all right, but about 90% of the poles that we set during the summer, I think the reason that you probably brought me back to help with is to redo some of this stuff that's going down right now, and that means inside a hot phase all the time. And one slip up, somebody's going to get hurt. It's just that simple.
Well, what are we looking at in terms of new used truck?
I would say that Kevin and I visited about his truck today. He has a little over 30,000 in his. I would like to have one that has the same type of capabilities as his does, with an upper set of controls and a bucket that was removable, which would fill in as a second bucket truck. I think that's a feasible thing to want, and the same size of digger, an 18-inch digger, which is what we have now. But I would like to have the truck set up basically like the one we have. The guys are used to this truck. They understand how it works. It has a seat on it, which is kind of a tell-like deal. Maltec picked it up. But the reason being that when that boom turns, the operator for that truck is looking up that boom, always. When you have a standoff operator where he stands on the back of the truck, there are certain points in that boom in the air that he cannot see what the guy in the air is doing. And, you know, at 2 o'clock in the morning, you take all the advantages you can get. So, but I would say that we would be, I've been looking at them and just, I've made some inquiries, but I haven't gotten any returns yet. Somewhere from 50,000 less. I'd like to stop at 50 and still have a good certified truck that's certified by a shop that's been through it, not something that was bought down on the corner, you know.
As far as not certified?
Well, it won't certify this year.
Because
it's just wore out. The boom's not insulated. The hydraulics won't pass. It needs a new rope. It needs a lot of things.
The boom's never been insulated?
No. Boom's not insulated. Only the third stage. And it's manual. You pull it out, stick the bucket on it. It's an 86 truck, but it's an 83 digger. The digger was mounted before. And we've been trading them every 20 years, trying to. That was about how long the last bucket truck was here. But we've had two old junk diggers. I mean, this one's been here since the late 80s, early 90s, I think. And it's been used a lot. It's not new by any means.
Okay, well, my first question is do we have money somewhere that we could do something like that?
I think I came the wrong night.
Oh, goodness. Or would we be looking
They're wanting to charge you $1,800 to put a wheel seal in?
It's $600 just for the wheel seal. That truck was built, those axles and those brakes on that truck was built for 3 years and 3 years only. Total cost was $1,737.16. Brakes used for it were $243. $580 for a cylinder. State to see us put a lot more money in this old truck. You know, if we, I don't, it doesn't have much value. I mean, if you took it out on the street corner to sell, it really doesn't have much value.
Okay, so somebody brought it up. Practically, how often would yours be available to rent?
Every day.
So,
I personally do not want to buy a truck. Like I said, we're getting enough debt load. We need to pay some stuff off before we keep doing this.
Yeah, I set my truck and had it tested before they get theirs tested, just for that reason. If it's here in town, they might be able to use it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what are we looking at in terms of a dollar amount to rent it?
Oh, I don't know. We should call and see, I guess. It's all. Very similar to the same controls that their truck would have.
Okay.
His is a stand-on truck. It's different than ours.
Right, yeah, but I mean the winch. And, I don't know. We'd have to negotiate that.
And see. How huge of a conflict of interest are we getting into?
If you are going to rent it, it would have to be comparable to other offers made in the rental line that's available, and then probably put it for bids, and that'd cover your conflict.
And do you have any idea where we would go to rent something like that?
There isn't anybody close. I mean, these, a lot of these trucks are rental trucks or lease rental trucks, and you rent them by the month, you know, or like that. The only problem that I have with that is what happens at 2 o'clock in the morning in a storm when we can't find him or can't get a hold of him?
Yeah. With
an and my guys are not, and my guys haven't run his truck or not comfortable with his truck, you know, that's another thing.
With an operator, it's $95 an hour.
And have you tested the hydraulics? I'll call Rich and have him test them, but you're going to pay for it when you do, and that's going to be another expense you're going to incur.
Well, I understand that.
Mine was 600. I have tested.
Hope you did.
Go ahead and have it tested, Jeff.
I'll do it.
Thank you. And then let us know.
I'll do it.
Next council meeting, what the results are.
If I can get him down here before next council meeting.
Or whenever.
Okay.
Yeah, I was just saying, and have him print up a bid of
what it takes to bring it up.
What it takes to fix it.
Okay. I'll do it. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Do we have any new business? Trash contract. Tell me that we're looking at some language changes.
I did print some the contract from the, it's not the legal size, but it just doesn't have the, and then it had the two options on the back side that we've seen already. But no definitive decision had been made.
I guess I would like to see the first one.
While you're looking at that, I think paragraph 7 you had me change. Did everybody, if everybody agrees with that?
That covers stockholders and everything, right?
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Okay.
You say the top one?
Uh-huh.
For 6 month period other than unresolved.
Right. I would think if we're having five legitimate complaints every 6 months that we need to, whether it's resolved or not, we have an issue that needs to be addressed.
I'll move to approve those changes.
Going with option number one?
Yeah. Option number one, top, and the changes to paragraph number 7.
I'll second it.
Okay, so you're approving the contract with?
With the addition of the top paragraph being added to it.
And that was Troy?
Yeah.
Kevin, for Kevin, and Troy. Is there any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
Joe Gillette calls 5 times a month.
They got to be legitimate complaints.
You get a lot of complaints from people that they just say, you know, I forgot to put it out. We go here.
Well,
but they don't. You guys miss me. You know,
Well, the way it is, given you, I mean, to me it's the only business in the country, or that I have ever known, that it gives you 21 days, or bare minimum of a month.
Yeah, well.
That you could actually not do a job and still get paid for it, Terry.
Yeah.
That ain't right.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the five or more in any 6 month period. That's kind of harsh, isn't it?
Well,
I don't think so. I'd like to see it less than that myself.
They take it under advisement. It doesn't say, it gives them the chance to review that.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's their and that's their function. If there's a lot of complaints, they can review. They can determine whether or not they're legitimate complaints or not. But if they got a problem, this puts them in the driver's seat to be able to solve the problem.
Well, and if there's a problem, you know, I need to know it too.
The way it's going to state now, they'll be filling out forms here, correct?
Yes, right. They are supposed to be filling out complaint forms.
Forms?
Yeah, yep. There'll be a complaint form that they have to come in and fill out in order to get the ball rolling.
Not you, Terry, the citizens.
Just a phone call and to a vet is not going to get it.
Yeah.
And if they call in, we'll fill out the form, and usually if they we mm-hmm. tell them to go ahead and call you or something, that's what we're going
to
put
actually,
on the form.
We, you know, we don't get too many complaints. Sometimes they call in here, but that's not really often.
Well, then it's not a problem.
Yeah, I was going to say the 6 month deal shouldn't be an issue at all. Then.
No, I'm not worried about. I'm not worried about that. I'm just worried about the number of them.
The number of complaints being called
in. The number is Well,
you just said a minute ago you don't hardly get any.
We don't.
So five in a 6 month period.
We don't.
We know,
but that can't change.
Well.
Well, and, you know, again, it just, like Rod said, it gives us the ability to address the situation and, you know, and see what we've got going on and what we need to do to resolve it.
Yeah, well, I really, you know, I have to comment about something. You know, that would be the only thing that I have an issue with, but, I mean, we can live with it.
Okay.
Well, and it's an easy way with the form, if it's the same complaint all the time, well then that addresses it and you know exactly what to talk to your guys about.
Well, I mean, you know, we really only have one complainer in town and everybody knows who he is.
That's not what we're referring to. That's not what we're trying to deal with. We're trying to deal with the legitimate concerns.
Right. Sure.
We haven't instated this form that they're talking about just for trash service. It's for all departments. Electric, water, sewer.
Yeah.
It's just a new city form, not trash only.
Okay, is there any further business?
Did anybody pencil in the number of years?
I don't have the contract for signature yet, but I do believe we said we agreed
on. I left a blank spot there.
Yeah, I think we agreed on 5 years, didn't we?
Five was what they agreed on.
Yeah. I have no idea.
That's what we talked about last
time. Yeah, it's 5, yeah.
So you'll get it drafted? So Rob will get it. The new contract put together, and then he'll get it to
you. I'll get him over here, and you can pick him up. Here, John.
What about this other blank? Rates changed, charged by the city shall be allowed.
$1.
$1.
Or the city can actually charge any amount they want.
Yeah, but we charge it all.
Yeah, Stafford charges too. They're going to raise that.
Have you found my dumpster yet?
No. I can loan you one. I've got three or four of them. I'll let you have the one with the best wheels.
That'd be cool.
I have no idea. The one I picked up had all the lids and had our initials on it.
Yeah.
You don't suppose it's in Bob's building?
Well, it could be. They're bubbling with that. We'll look.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries 4-0.